Sunday after maybe a long time. For the last few months, we have been on a journey, and we've been thinking about what it means to be in vocation. What does it mean to live into the call that God has on our lives? And so we spent several weeks just talking and thinking about all the varying ways that call intersects with who we are and how we live and operate in the world. Not just our call, our vocation, our job in terms of what we get paid to do, but the ways in which we engage vocation in our relationships and in our parenting and in our engagement and interactions with one another. And then after some time, we moved a bit further, and we as a group, many of us, engaged in a thing called the Enneagram. Some of you are familiar with that. And so we were interested in, who is this person who shows up for the call? Who is this person? How did God create me? How does God create me to engage and interact with others? And how does the body of Christ engage together in whatever ways that God has called us? So after coming out of our Enneagram retreat, we found ourselves at the doorsteps of Advent. Now, you've heard me say before that Advent is different for some of us. It's new, maybe depending on what tradition we may have come from. And so Advent is pretty much the way that we say we don't just show up on Christmas like, yay, Christ is born. But it allows us to sort of slow down and try to enter into the story a little bit further before the baby is actually born, and sort of take that walk with people who were longing in years ago for the manifestation of what God had promised. It allows us to slow down and take that walk with Mary and with Joseph and with the shepherds, just like we did today. It allows us to have time to actually meditate and steep ourselves in the grand story that people all over the world are also entering into in this season, so that when we do show up, if the Lord wills, on Christmas Eve and on Christmas morning, we show up in a way that helps us to be able to enter in some way into the fullness of that joy. You see, it's not so much that we don't know if the baby's going to be born, although sometimes our liturgy can act kind of suggest that, but it is that Advent is a time for us to take note of what it means when we are in seasons of waiting in our lives, whenever those seasons of waiting might be. See, Advent doesn't necessarily have to be in the winter when it happens in real time. When we have to wait for a job, when we have to wait for a baby, when we have to wait for God to give us what God promised, when we have to wait for things to change, the winds of change in our marriages and in our health, when we have to wait, we can lean back to this time of year and say, what did we learn during Advent that we can apply as we long and as we wait in other aspects of our lives? That's what Advent is really about. And one of the things that we realize that is so critical to us as we do our work and trying to understand what God has called us to do and who God has called us to be is the matter of vulnerability. And we know this is important. Why? Because our great and powerful and indescribable and awesome God would step down off of the lofty place of heaven and would take on a coat of skin and would crawl into the womb of a woman and would become the most vulnerable of them all. Indeed, as children, help us understand, a baby, God would become flesh in Emmanuel, one with us. God becomes vulnerable with us. And so last week, we talked about how God became vulnerable in his baby and how vulnerability, it is not a place to stay, but vulnerability is the birthplace. It's the labor and delivery, if you will, for love and for creativity and for belonging and for longing and for all of the things that make for flourishing. It all starts with vulnerability. But then when we hear the word vulnerable, if you're like me, then your tendency is to think, I don't want to really be vulnerable. First of all, often in our world, when we think about vulnerable people, we think about people who have not themselves chosen to be vulnerable, but people who have been made vulnerable, right, by certain circumstances. It's not that they have revealed their poverty, but that poverty has been made known because of circumstances, because security has been pulled off of them, because protection has been pulled off of them, because of the things that we get to grasp and hold on to so we don't have to be vulnerable has been pulled off of them and therefore has exposed them without often their permission or longing. So when we think about someone saying we should be vulnerable, I don't know If I make myself vulnerable, people are going to take advantage of me. If I make myself vulnerable, people are going to think I'm weak. They're going to think I'm a punk. They're going to think, right? And so what is this thing about vulnerability that is supposed to be attractive to us? But there's a difference between the vulnerability that this world imposes that pulls off and rips off and exposes, and the vulnerability of God in Christ that we are called to in our lives and in our vocation at this call, is a vulnerability that is, according to Brene Brown, a social researcher, it is a willingness, not an ability, because anybody has the ability, but it is a willingness to show up and to be seen when there's no way to control the outcome. I'm going to say that again. This call, vocare, let me talk about vocation, and vocation literally means the call. So the call of God, for the people of God to be vulnerable, according to Brene Brown, is the willingness. That takes courage.
Yes.
You got to be brave to be willing. The willingness to show up and be seen fully for who you are when you have no control over the outcome. That's vulnerable. God came to his own. Showed up on the stage of humanity. Allowed God's self to be fully seen in flesh and in blood. And his own received him not. The risk of vulnerability is great. And God put all of those things upon Christ. The core of vulnerability is the willingness to be seen. And this thing about being seen is not just about being eyeballed. It's not just about being peeked at, but it is about being known. So Jesus says to this earthly mother and earthly father, didn't you know, Mary, didn't you remember what the angel said to you? I bring you good news, good tidings of great joy. For you shall give birth to a son. His name shall be called. Didn't you know that I'd be about my father's business? One translation says. Didn't you know, Joseph, that the angel spoke to you and told you, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife because she has conceived of the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a baby, and his name shall be called Jesus, which means Emmanuel, which is God with us. Didn't you know? For I made myself vulnerable. And God had revealed to you, didn't you know that I would be about my father's business? God comes to earth, puts on flesh, because God wants to be seen. God wants to be known. And so if we see Jesus, we see God.
Yes.
We see how Jesus acts, that's how God acts. And we see how Jesus interacts, that's how God interacts. And we see what breaks Jesus' heart, then we see what breaks the heart of God. If you have seen me, Jesus says, you have seen the Father.
Yes.
God becomes flesh because God wants to be seen. One of my favorite literary projects of all time, anyone who knows me just a little bit would know, is The Color Purple by Alice Walker. And there's a scene when two of the main characters, Miss Seeley and Shug Avery, are walking in a garden, if you've seen the movie, and Shug turns to Seeley and says, I think it pisses God off. Excuse me. She still said, God off. If you walk past the color purple in a field and not notice it. She said, are you saying God is vain? No, he just doesn't want you to miss a good thing. God wants to be seen. God wants to be known that God has made, God moved from behind the cloud, has moved from the cleft of the rock, has moved out from the shadowy places and entered into the light in flesh. Vulnerable. But don't you know that vulnerability is a necessary ingredient for connection, God, with us, in order for God to be with us, in order for this connection to take hold, to snap in, and it's essential that vulnerability be on the menu. Believers of God, as image bearers of God, we too have a deep longing and need at our core for connection, all right? We all want to feel like we're part of something else, something more. We all want to be connected. The communion table is about connection. We come in remembrance and we connect ourselves. Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me. We connect ourselves. But that day when Jesus sat with his disciples, even Peter, even Judas, we connect ourselves with all those who have already come to the table long before we breathe our first breath. We come to the table for connection, for there we connect and commune, come into union with God and with each other. The communion table, yes, connects us to a hope and all those who long for the hopes and fears of all these years that are met in Christ. The great host at the table, the communion table, is about connection. We all long for connection. Advent is about connection. But friends, the hard part is this. We can't control the outcome. Even if the angels reveal to us, like he did Mary and Joseph, Jesus still couldn't determine the outcome. Even if God comes down to earth and puts it against it to us in a book, God still can't determine the outcome, how we will respond to God's vulnerability. Even if the Holy Spirit takes up residence in our hearts, God does not control how we respond to the vulnerability of God at Christmas or any time of the year. Didn't you know? When you know that I would be about my Father's business, didn't you know? We can't control the outcome when it comes to vulnerability. Because, you know, if we become vulnerable, if we take off the superhero mask, huh? If we take off the Incredible Hulk pillows, right? If we take off all of the things that make us show up in the world shiny and strong and smart and capable and competent, if we take off all of those things and let ourselves be seen, known. Somebody might ask. They might hate what they see. They might reject us. People who once embraced and applauded us might reject us. Tell us, treat us like we're less than and not enough. Hey, we might be made sorrowful. We might be grieved in our spirit. We might be wounded to our core. We might be bruised at our ego, our peace, the pseudo-peace bubble that we live in that gives us such comfort might be busted and destroyed. The risk of the incarnation and the kind of vulnerability it demands is great. It is this risk, beloved, that we enter into at Christmas. This is the risk we save. This is the risk that we scurry about for. This is the risk that we worship and lift up holy hands and that we gather around the life. Because God looked at the manger and said, Maple Avenue Ministry Church, of Jesus Christ, believers of the same, God said, I placed all of your iniquity, all your sin, all your stuff upon Christ. We become vulnerable. We might be despised. But God put that on him. He was despised and rejected. Mm-hmm. We might find ourselves greedy. God put that on him, despised and rejected, filled with grief. God put it upon Christ. All of the things that exploit, all of the things that insult, all of the things that deny vulnerability, God put it on him. Mm. Despised, it's on him. Rejected, it's on him. Grieved, it's on him. Wounded, it's on him. Bruised, it's upon him who knew no sin. 2 Corinthians 5:21, to become sin for us. Mm. God placed it all on Jesus. Mm. The greater one who lives in us is willing to be seen in us. But there is a cost. A cost that is greater than our own fear of rejection. A cause that is greater than any hurt or pain that might be inflicted upon us because we can't determine the end. There's a cost in order to know him, in order to see him, in order for him to know and be seen in us. And the Apostle Paul said it like this. He said, all of the trappings, all of the masks, all of the labels, all of them, according to the Jewish law, I'm a Jew of all Jews. I'm a Pharisee of all Pharisees. I was born on the right day. The right time, and I'll tell you what, all of those things had to become to me as nothing.
Yes. Yes.
So that I might know.
Mm.
So that I might know the one who made himself known. So that I might see the one who revealed himself behind the that I might know him in the power of his resurrection. I'm talking about all power. That I might know him in the fellowship of his suffering. Comes with great cost, beloved. And letting go of our stuff. The stuff that makes us worthy hides our true worthiness. That is only revealed in vulnerability. When there's nothing else left to hide from, when there's no fig trees with which to cover ourselves, to cover our lumps and our bumps and our weaknesses, and we can't control how people will receive it. But it does matter. Leaning in anyway, having the willingness to show up and to be seen when we cannot determine the outcome, what sets us on the course to be about our Father's business. For our Father's business is connection. Everything that stands between God and humanity, everything that stands between human beings and human beings, and everything that stands between us and our very selves is made clearer, feels closer, and is known deeper when we endeavor to know the one whose business is to take on the barriers to connection.
Mm.
Connection between us and us and us. When we dare to be willing, to be vulnerable as the God who lives in us, in Christ, for his glory. Amen.
Amen.
Let's pray together. Holy gracious God, we thank you, praise you for the gift of your word. Yea, even Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Thank you that he is not hidden. You're not hiding yourself from us, but you have been fully revealed by the power of your Spirit. So now break the bricks off of our hearts, oh God, that you would find a heart of flesh, soft and pliable, that the seed of your word would go down deep like a tree planted by rivers of water that will bring forth fruit with seed in it in its season. This is our desire, Lord. For your glory, for your glory, your glory alone. Nothing is too hard for you. Help our unbelief. In the name of Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Spirit, world without end, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen.
Amen. Can we stand together?